will celebrate the feast of St. Mary Magdalene. And she in this chapel here, yes, she is in the church right above the altar, kneeling at the feet of our Lord, the crucifixion. And I like to speak about St. Mary Magdalene because she's a unique saint. As we know, she was a great sinner. And when our Lord began his public life, grace touched her heart, and she converted from her wicked ways and followed our Lord. St. Mary Magdalene, we know, was the woman who, when Jesus was eating with a Pharisee named Simon, she came in right in the middle of the banquet and knelt down at Jesus' feet and began to cry, washed our Lord's feet, and wiped it with her hair. And Simon the Pharisee, seeing this in his mind, said about Jesus, if he was a prophet, surely he would know what person she is. She's a sinner. And our Lord said to Simon, Simon, I have something to ask you. He said, speak, Lord. And he gives the parable of a man had two debtors. One owed a lot and one owed very little. And he forgave them both. He said, who did he love more? He said, I suppose he who he forgave more. And Jesus said, you have spoken rightly. He said, when I came into your house, you didn't wash my feet, you didn't wash my hands, and yet this woman here has done nothing but bathing her my feet with her tears. And he says, many sins are forgiven her because she has loved much. Now when we think of St. Mary Magdalene, we are reminded that there are many occasions in which she comes up. But on one occasion, our Lord speaks about what she did in anointing our Lord's feet. And he says, as long as this gospel is preached, this story will be told to the end of time. And our Lord's prophecy has been fulfilled. On another occasion, this was toward the end of our Lord's public life, near his passion and death, she came in and broke a very expensive perfume and anointed our Lord's feet. Who was it that complained about it? It was Judas. Now Judas said, why was this ointment wasted? Why did we sell this and then the money given to the poor? But it says right in the gospel, it wasn't that he was concerned about the poor, it's that he had the purse and he wanted the money. But our Lord rebuked Judas and said, the poor you will always have, but you will not always have me. And she has done me a good favor. We also know that this is the same Mary Magdalene, who was sister to Martha and to Lazarus. And when Lazarus had died, and Jesus tarried coming when he was sick, when Jesus comes to Bethany and they give word that Lazarus had died, and Martha is weeping and saying, Lord, if you had been here, my brother wouldn't have died. And our Lord sees these people weeping, and it says in the gospel that Jesus also wept. Jesus was indeed true God, but also true man. And he had compassion on these poor people, especially Martha, for losing her brother. And our Lord raised Lazarus from the dead. We also know when our Lord was visiting Bethany that Mary knelt at our Lord's feet. And Martha was busy about this and about that and trying to get everything ready for the food and very, very, you know, anxious about these things. And what did our Lord say when Martha said, Lord, tell Mary to help me? Was she just sitting there, kneeling there? She's not doing anything. But she was praying. And Jesus said, Martha, Martha, thou art busy about many things, but one thing is necessary, one thing is important, and Mary has chosen the better part. And oftentimes, spiritual writers compare the two types of religious life, the contemplative and the active. Martha represents the active life, and Mary represents the contemplative life. But Mary Magdalene, God's grace touched her heart, and from being a great sinner, she became a great saint. What does this teach us? What lesson is there for us to learn in this? Number one, God forgives sins no matter how many or how great, if we're truly sorry, we're truly repentant, and we have a firm purpose of amendment. And that was the case with Mary Magdalene. She truly repented of her past sins, and she turned a new life. That should give all of us confidence. And I'd like to share this with you. When you deal with people that are dying, the devil is very clever. He knows the work on your head, get in your head, and try to get you to despair of God's mercy, or get discouraged, or be frightened. Indeed, we should make atonement for our past sins. Indeed, we should make reparation for them. That's why we do penance for our sins. That's why we should carry our crosses in life patiently. But let not the devil tempt us to despair of God's mercy and love for us. And especially when we're dying, to have us lose hope and confidence. Because once he gets us there, he can easily make us fall into other sins, doubting God's mercy, doubting God's love, and losing our faith and trust and confidence in God. Another thing when we think of Mary Magdalene is this: we should never give up on anybody, no matter how great a sinner or how terrible their sins. Remember, Jesus suffered and died and shed his blood for that poor sinner too. And we should never cease to pray and sacrifice for them. And when there's an opportunity to put a good word in there, make some type of a comment to make them think, when that window of opportunity opens itself, take that opportunity, take that advantage, and try to bring them back to God. St. James says, "He who converts a sinner from his wicked ways will cover a multitude of his sins." That's how pleasing to God is the conversion of sinners. And we should never, ever despair of anybody. Those of you, especially parents who have children that are wayward, rather than thinking about it, getting discouraged or depressed, every time the devil or the thought comes to your mind, the devil suggests about how bad they are or what the situation is, etc., it gets you down. Getting down is not going to help, but praying a prayer for them is. So when those thoughts of your children come, something, you know, reminds you about them and their need to come back to God, turn that thought into a prayer. Commend them to the Sacred Heart of Jesus and to the Immaculate Heart of Mary with great trust and confidence. And remember to generously pray and sacrifice for them. Now, St. Mary Magdalene, she's a great example that not all the saints were born saints. Same thing with St. Augustine. Same thing with St. Camillus de Lillis, whose feast we recently celebrated. And there's a whole list of them, how God's grace converted them. And this should give us all hope and confidence that by the grace of God, no matter how weak we are and what our sins might be, God's grace can help pull us up and out of sin and to live a life of grace. So on this Sunday, when we think of Jesus having compassion on the crowds, let us remind ourselves the same Jesus that had compassion on the crowds nearly 2,000 years ago, the same Jesus today. And whenever we have the misfortune of offending him or falling, let's go to him with great trust and confidence. The other thing I'd like to briefly speak about, because we're talking about sinners, is about sin. Real quick catechism lesson. What is sin? Sin is a willful thought, word, or action, or omission forbidden by the law of God. And I stress the word willful. For it to be a sin, you have to know it's a sin, and you have to willfully do it. There are differences between sin. There are venial sins, light sins, and there are what we call mortal sins, because mortal means death. It robs our soul of the state of sanctifying grace, the life of God in our soul. If we die in a state of mortal sin, then we go to hell. Three things necessary for a mortal sin: serious matter, mindful of it at the time, and full consent of the will. Or as we say to little children, It's a big sin. I know it's a big sin, and I want to do it anyway. Those are the three elements for mortal sin. When we think of temptation, let's remember that temptation is not sin. If the devil's tempting us, or maybe our fallen human nature, or something in the world's alluring us away from God, to disobey Him, to offend Him, that temptation is not a sin, as long as we don't want it. Sometimes people get really discouraged and really depressed. Oh, I can't believe how horrible those thoughts are, how horrible those suggestions are. I just don't want them. It's making me really, really gets me down. Temptations are not sin unless we give in to the temptation. We pray and we say to our Father, lead us not into temptation. Let us not succumb to temptation. Holy Job tells us our life on earth is a temptation. We're surrounded by temptations. But this is the battle, the struggle, the effort we have to make to gain the kingdom of heaven. And if we can make it a habit in time of temptation to pray, then we have very good reason to believe when we didn't consent. Even the saints, even the holiest of saints, had great temptations. They had great trials and tribulations and difficulties. God was testing them that they might prove their love for Him. So in time of temptation, do not get discouraged. And one last thing, when it comes to sin, let us not say about venial sin, it's only a little sin. It's not a big deal. No, venial sin, even though it's small, weakens us and makes us more susceptible to commit mortal sin. And let's remember this, too. If we love God, and I'm sure we do, and we have to really, truly want to even offend Him in small matters. Not just the big things, but even in the small things. And let us remember, for all of our sins, even though they're forgiven, we have to make atonement for them. That's the purpose of penance. That's the purpose of carrying our crosses in life. And if we were just to start calculating now, let's say hypothetically, Scripture says the just man falls seven times, etc. a day. We start calculating those things. If we start adding them up, how easy those things accumulate, and how important it is that we fight against sin and don't make peace with us. And like I say, it's only the venial sin, not a big deal. No, we need to atone for those venial sins, either in this life by voluntary penance, or in the next in purgatory. So St. Mary Magdalene is a wonderful example. Many sins were forgiven her because she loved much, and she was truly contrite. As we read Scripture, contrite in a humble heart, God will not despise. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost. Amen.